Good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Lotte and the organizing team for giving me this opportunity to talk to you today about what the National Library of France is doing in terms of collections as data and digital humanities. So this is the title of my presentation today. And I was thinking it's Monday morning, and you've all been traveling and you're probably tired and just ride on the bus and everything. So I thought we should probably start with something a little more fun. So today I will talk to you about fairy tales. Fairy tales are really important to life, to our everyday life. And by the way, this is not me trying to reach the top of digital humanities. This is Rapunzel, an illustration by Arthur Wacom that you can see in Gallica, our digital library. So yes, recently I was reading things about fairy tales in a paper in a French journal, and they were saying that fairy tales are instrumental in helping children understand people with disabilities, and that it helped them cope with the disabilities, make them less strange, and know how to interact with these people. And we're thinking, wow, fairy tales have been there forever. And we're still understanding things on how they can help us with everyday life and help us grow and better understand the world around us. So this is really amazing research. And really, stories like fairy tales are really important. You probably know this citation. You can start counting how many times you see them in conferences. It's my second time. Stories are really powerful. And if you look at the humanities as a science, regardless of whether the humanities are digital or not, humanities is an interesting thing. It's an interesting science. It has something different. Has a scientific approach. It doesn't try to create something new. It doesn't try to discover things. It tries to better understand things that are already there, like fairy tales, for instance. So the humanities as the science of studying these stories and sometimes building these stories is really something that is instrumental in creating the world where we are, the world where we work, the world we will live. It's really that's the most powerful and important thing about the humanities. So if we look at the digital humanities and the way it affects libraries, maybe it's the same. Maybe it's not about discovering something new, but it's about rediscovering something that has always been there. And if you look at how the humanities have started, the humanists in the 16th century, they were interested in the Latin, the Greeks, the ancient history. So, of course, my presentation of what we are doing today in the field of digital humanities at the BNF will start with this sentence, once upon a time. Of course, my... And it kind of starts in 1934, which is the date where we opened what you can see on the picture, which is the catalogues room. So before that date, at the BNF, it was a very impressive reading room. If you go there in the older building that has been renovated and reopened recently, you can go study, or you can just go visit this wonderful reading room. It's very big, very, very impressive. And at the center of this reading room, you had something that was called the hemicycle. And that was the place where the librarian was. And if you wanted to look for something in the library, you had to walk to that person that was on the top above you and like ask them if they would please consult the catalog for you so that you can find something. And the librarian would do the search, and then he would tell the researcher where to find his book, hopefully, in the mass of collections that were inside the National Library that were very difficult already to get accounted with. So this was like that until the beginning of the 20th century. And at that moment, there was a librarian at the BNF called Suzanne Briet, who decided that things needed to change and that librarians and researchers needed to interact with one another, not one being on the stage above the other, but together in the same room. And they created this room for consulting the catalogs so that the researchers could consult the catalogs themselves. And this room was in the basement, so it was a very small room and very, well, not so impressive and amazing than the major reading room. But the researcher loved it because they had the possibility to consult the catalog themselves. They had the possibility to interact with the librarian that was not above them, but at the same level, and to do things together, to have this proximity between the librarian and the researchers. And it was the only way to actually access the collections in a way that was really useful for the researchers. And they could even make suggestions, so it was collaborative. They could ask for librarian to buy such a book and things like that. So it was a great success, this catalog reading room. It was a great success until the end of the 20th century. And then what happened? What has changed? What has changed is that we started to have computers, and then we started to have data. So the situation changed in 1985. That's the date where you had the first catalog on a computer in the catalog reading room. That's the first place where they set it. And of course, at the beginning, it was very complicated to use the computer catalogs. So the researcher had to ask the librarian if they would please use the computer catalog for them. And it was back to the before the catalogs reading room. And then what happened at the BNF is that we constructed a new building with four towers that is near the Seine. Maybe you've been there or you can visit it if you ever go to Paris. And in 1992, the printed collection moved from the ancient... Oh, sorry. What did I do? Okay. okay, I'm going to put it there. So the ancient the collections, the printed collections, moved from the ancient building to the new building. And in that new building, there wasn't needed to have a catalog reading room, because the catalog was everywhere, on every computer, in every place of the reading room. So what happened to the people who were working in that area is that some of them worked then in a department that was called, oh, I don't even know how it was called. Today it's called the metadata department. It was probably not called like that at that time. And part of them became reference librarians. And the reading room that inherited the catalog's reading room, it's reading room X. You know, every reading room has a letter at the BNF, so you have A, B, C, and so on. And then you don't have a W, but you have a X. And the X reading room is the reference reading room. It's the place where you find biographies, printed catalogs, card catalogs still, and where you find reference librarians that can help you with the mass of collections that the BNF provides to researchers. So in that reading room is that's the place where we had the first computer with Gallica, the digital library on it. That was 1997. And that's also in the X reading room that we installed the first computer with the web archives. That was 2008. So yes, you know, that kind of makes sense that as time goes by, this X reading room will become the place for digital humanities. But let's not go too fast with my story. And speaking about the data and what has changed. So I mentioned the web archives. We have 1 petabyte of those today. The digitized objects that are available in our digital library. So if you go to Gallica online, you have about 5 million items digitized in the digital library, not only BNF, it's also national digital library with almost 400 partners. But if you go inside on site, you also have access to 0.5 million objects that are in copyright. So that cannot be displayed on the internet, but are in the in-house version of Gallica. And
Of course, you have the metadata records of the catalog, so that's an approximate number. Bibliographic records, authority records. And then I should also add audiovisual material, that's about 2 petabytes today. And the electronic documentation that we acquire for the use by researchers. And also other types of data, technical data that we have in our digital preservation system, logs data, all kinds of data. And what happened a few years ago was that all these collections, all these data that we made available started unveiling some different kind of interests for the researchers. The researchers until then had used these digital collections as some kind of surrogate to the analog collection. So if you looked at a book in Gallica, it more or less looks like we try to reinvent to recreate in the digital world the experience that you had in the physical world. So you can take the book, turn the pages, read the table of contents and stuff like that. You can do additional things like search inside the book or inside the whole collections, but it still pretty much looks like a library. And then in around the mid-2010 years, so 2014, 2015, we started having researchers who were really interested in these masses of data in a different way. They really wanted to experiment things differently and to consider this digital amount of data as a whole. And so I will tell you a story. That's my thing today. One day there was a researcher, the director of laboratory in France with interested in literature, came to us and asked us if we could have a copy of Gallica. So at that time Gallica wasn't 5 million items, it was only 3 million. But still, we asked him, that's a lot, are you sure you want that? And he said, yes, I'm sure. I want to study a really big bunch of text. I'm doing big data analysis. And yes, I would like a copy of everything you have. So that raised a lot of questions. First, we tried to understand if you really wanted a copy of the whole of the whole repository. And he was interested in text. So we narrowed it down. We pushed the image apart. We focused on text. And then we asked ourselves, are we allowed to do that? Is there any copyright or licensing issue? Is it a problem, a branding problem maybe for the library to give that much data to someone else? We probably need to make some kind of memorandum of understanding with these researchers before we give it to them. And what are they going to do with it? Are they going to reconstruct Gallica and we will lose part of our audience? Etc. And then we had more questions once we were more or less convinced that we were allowed to do it and that it was a good thing. How to do it? How to extract, which was finally not 3 million but only 130,000 digitized books, well, the OCR version, not the images, from Gallica. How do we extract that? And if we give it to them, is it useful? No, they also need the metadata, but in what format, and so on. And then we had another question, which was, okay, now we know what they need, and we know what we're going to give them, but how do we do it? Is it the IT who will be in charge of extracting the content, or is it the digitization service, or is it the metadata service, because they know how to do it for the metadata, but not for the files, and so on. So it took us about 18 months between the moment where the researcher first knocked on our door asking for a copy of Gallica and the moment when we handed him over the 130,000 digitized books for his research. By the way, if you're interested, it's linked to the Common Places project, so you can search it. They had a presentation in DH some years ago, and it's really interesting what they do. They're trying to find citations in text, even in an unexpected way. So you could find a citation of Shakespeare in a biology book, and it makes sense to know why these citations become so preeminent.
But that's not my point here. The point is that it's really not satisfying for a library to take 18 months in acceding to that kind of request. We needed to be faster, we needed to be more efficient, and we were convinced, even if it was the first time, we were really convinced that this would happen again, and this would happen more and more. So we had to handle it and to create a process so that that kind of request could be served more efficiently. So that's when we created this project, the Corpus project. So Corpus is a project that I'm leading in the internal research plan of the library. It's a four-year project, so we started in 2016 and we are about at the end of the project. Doesn't mean that we have finished, we're still climbing the hair of Rapunzel, but we've done some work. So what happened before we started the project is, as you understand, we didn't have an organized process. So whenever someone was asking for raw, massive data for computational purposes, what we were doing was we were reinventing the wheel from the starting point to how we're allowed to do it until the end point where how do we actually deliver the file. So we really needed to have a process to improve that. We also wanted people to know that we were able to do that. If they had new projects emerging, to make this easily accessible to them. So we started this project and we decided to spend 4 years, or at least 3 years, experimenting with researchers, trying to understand what kind of services they were interested in. And at the end of these 3 years, the idea was that the fourth year, we would take the lessons learned and design a new service for providing that kind of services to researchers. Actually, it went faster than expected. And we are at the end of the project, but we already have very, very good results. So I don't really have time to go through all the achievements of the Corpus project. I will just highlight some of them. You can find other presentations where I tell more about what we've done. In the first 2 years of the project, we started experimenting with researchers, and this is the two main achievements. The first one that you see on the top is a website that was created for the hackathon 2017, and it's documenting all the APIs and all the data sets that we have created to access massively the collections, and especially the ones that are freely accessible online. So it was the first time that we would document all that in a website. You can find on that website the dataset that you created for the people who came with asking for a copy of whole Gallica. This is a reusable dataset now. And the other achievement that you see on the bottom is an interface that we created for the researchers that were our companion team for the first year of Corpus. It's the interface where we provide full text indexing of the web archives. So during these first years, what we discovered is that working with researchers from different areas, different disciplines, they have very different expectations. If you're working with linguists or with IT people, researchers, they want the data as raw as possible because they have the tools. But there needs some knowledge on how the data is structured and what the collections are about. They want that kind of collections knowledge. If you're working with, for instance, historians, at least in France, they don't necessarily have easy access to IT skills in their teams. It's quite difficult. So what they expected from us working on the history of the internet before 2000 was to provide some tool that would help them search the web and access it in a different way. So we designed this interface for them, and they had personalized functions that could save their search and download all kinds of metadata in CSV and things like that.
Another thing that we have achieved in these years is that we have brought people together. And that's an interesting thing, that as a national library, we are not tied to a specific university, we are not tied to a specific discipline in terms of human science. So it's a nice place where you can gather people that are maybe working on very different things but want to share on their methodology and the kind of data they are creating. And although there are already many places, especially in the research and higher education field, where people can meet and can discuss that kind of stuff, they were still very happy to come to the National Library to be able to discuss that. So we organized a series of workshops. You can check the topics and have the resumes of the workshops online on our weblog. Of course, it's all in French, but you can use any automated translation, artificial intelligence, and it's quite helpful now, so it has made a lot of progress. So by the end of the year 2017, we started looking for the researcher. So, okay, everything is nice, we're experimenting, we kind of have an idea of the new services that we want to build and what we want to achieve, but who is it for? So then we had someone, Eleonora Moiragi, who is in this room today, work on the study to identify what were the potential public and the needs of the researchers who would maybe use one day these services. So we worked with Eleonora on trying to create a persona, so typical users. She ran a series of interviews, and then we had a workshop at the end to check if what we thought was correct. And then we published this report that is available online. It's open access, and it's still in French. And what are the main findings of the study? The main focus of the study actually was one question, which was, is it useful to create a physical space for that activity? Because we were convinced about the virtual space. We already had the API website I showed you before. But we were wondering if we could use these digital humanities collections as data thing to make people come to the library. So that was the main focus of Eleonora's study. And what we discovered was obviously that the researchers, as soon as they work on digital material, kind of assume that it should be available anywhere. And they are not necessarily aware of the limitations, including copyright limitations, that we may face in providing access to this content. In France, the legal deposit, so that includes the web archives, can only be accessed on the premises of the library. So if they're studying recent material, they more or less have to come. And what we have, of course, is that the researchers won't come to the library for the collections, as you probably already know, and we already knew before we conducted the study. If the collections are not available, they may even change their mind and decide to work on something else altogether, because it's more easily accessible, and that's true for every discipline. So we discussed with them, trying to understand how we could make them come. And they said that the human dimension was the most important, and they would come if we provided a way to access easily to experts that can help them gain time in trying to cope with the collections and the tools around the collections. So the API website is very useful, but if they can see someone that explains to them instead of reading the 100 pages of the explanation of the MARC format, it's easier for them somehow. And also, they wanted to work together, so meet their peers. A teacher wanted to have his students come to the library to discover the place. And they wanted to that's really the human part that was important to them. So this is this diagram is the conclusion of Eleonora's study, and it demonstrates something really new and unexpected, which is that these people actually need a library. Wow. So yes, a library when you can have access for the researchers and also access for the staff, where you can study as a group, where you can present things that you've done, where you can hold small events, have coffee and things like that. So if you look at the different things around here, most of them are things that we already have on the library, but the library is big, and the library is has been here forever. So maybe for the digital humanities to be more visible, we needed to gather all these services in one place. And then there was also something new about what we needed to build, which is that we needed a digital infrastructure that would allow the researcher to launch a query and take a coffee, or maybe two coffees, or maybe a full week of coffee while it's computing the data because it's so big. And then he comes back and, wow, the work is done. So we needed that kind of infrastructure, and then we needed services because, as I told you, it's all about the human part. So this is an overview of the different services that we plan to have at the end of the Corpus project. So the first column here is data creation and extraction. So on-demand digitization is something that we are already doing, but on a very small scale. If a patron wants to have a page of a book or even a full book reproduced in digital form, they can ask for it, they pay, and they get it. And it also goes to Gallica if it's public domain. So the idea is to scale that and to be able to digitize a full corpus for a team, a researcher team, if they want to. That's something that we already do, but as I told you, we were kind of reinventing the wheel each time we were asked that, so now we have a clear process to do it. We also plan to have on-demand web archiving. It's a bit more difficult because we're only web archiving in the framework of the legal deposit, so it should be the French web, which has no meaning whatsoever. And we're still working on how we can do that, but we know that some teams are interested in doing web archiving for sociology studies or things like that. There are other institutions that do it for the researcher. They can archive the web, but they don't necessarily preserve it because we have the right to preserve and not necessarily them. So the idea is to work also with university libraries. If they create a corpus for their researchers, we can also integrate that corpus in the archive so that the researcher can later on find again the kind of websites that he used for his research. Data extraction and querying through APIs, I've mentioned it through the website already. It's a bit more challenging to do it on web archives, difficult to say what's the French web. It's also difficult to extract one website because we don't know what it is either. So this data extraction process needs to be improved, but we know now how to extract a lot of things from our digital collections, and also to extract technical things like logs, if people want to study how Gallica is used, for instance. That's the kind of things that we've been doing in the past few years. We plan to have to provide a digital infrastructure, as I told you, and also to provide tools. So it's quite complicated for libraries to provide tools for researchers because they evolve faster than the information system of the library does. So if we were to wait for a tool to be mature enough to integrate the library information system, probably it would be useless already for the researcher. So it's more collaboration here. We provide the infrastructure. We will work with researchers who have developed tools to manipulate the data, so machine learning tools, AI for mining images, visualization software, things like that. And we will work with this research team for them to install the tools in our infrastructure and maybe help other researchers to use them. We will provide a workspace, something that looks like very much like a reading room, but we've been asking lots of questions on things like sound and silence. People want to work as a group, and then the reader next to them wants to work in the quiet reading room, and the space is so big at the BNF, it's a little difficult to handle that. And also, I was talking about coffee because it's almost impossible to convince a researcher who is working with digital documents that his coffee is dangerous for the documents. It's obviously dangerous for the laptop, but for the collections, not so much. So, yes, the idea was to try to find some way for the collections and the coffee to be able to be in the same space or not far from one another, which is not really easy in a national library. We want to have on-site events that could include research seminars, but also meetings and trainings. We want to allow teachers to come to the library with their students. Actually, we had a team from the Digital Humanities Center in Lausanne, in the École Polytechnique de Lausanne, Frédéric Caplon, who came to doing this visit at the beginning of the master, really changed the mindset of the students and interested them more. So that's some kind of finding in interaction between something that is digital, that is sometimes difficult to wrap its hand around, and something that is really very physical. We want to have residences, so allow researchers to have their own office and live at the library for the time of their research. If it's a research project, it can be 1 year, 3 years. If it's a thesis, it can be 3 years. And of course, we want to have the reference librarians of the reading room have a specific training to help all these people and to have experts of the collections, the technical experts and legal experts available to discuss with them. We're also discussing business models. So in order for this service to be sustainable, we really have to think about how we're going to handle it in terms of funding. So we have different models that are already experimented at the BNF. I mentioned on-demand digitization services, which is a basic pay service. So the client pays for the service, basically. But we have other models. We have a funding, a partnership model where the library becomes a partner in a funded project. There is the project hotel model, which is a model that has been labeled this way by Campus Condorcet, which is a humanities university that will open this September. The idea is that you host a project, you don't really participate in it, but you offer them a space, a workspace. And then hosting several projects allows for them to interact with one another. And also, we already have hosted research teams like the Ehimus Institute for Musical Research. So that's something that's not completely new to us. And you also have the model of premium services. We experimented at the BNF with PRISM, which is a dedicated service for companies, startups and things like that. They can have a special card and it opens the possibility to have access to special services inside the library. Like they have a group room that is dedicated to them, they can get special meetings with people in charge of economy at the BNF, things like that. So maybe that could inspire us also for the
the model of the future service that we are building. So finally, the word human is more important than the word digital. That's my point from the beginning, and you got it. I won't discuss the virtues of distant reading versus close reading. This is really not my topic as a librarian. My topic is to help the researchers who want to do either one do it better, more efficiently, in a place that's satisfying for them, and with access to the collections they needed. So what we're doing is that we're transforming one of the reading room, and that's the ex-reading room, the one that I was mentioning at the beginning. And that's really a nice story as well. We were looking for some place to host this service, and I was discussing with people from the library who are in charge of the reading rooms, and we asked them if they had a small place, maybe hidden somewhere, where we could use a meeting room and a training room, and that would be it. And they said, "Oh no, please use the ex-reading room. It really needs to be reinvented. It needs a new purpose, because a reference room is something that the readers don't refer to easily nowadays. So all the other rooms of the building are organized according to disciplines, and people don't have necessarily, they don't go straight away to the reference room. They go to the history room, or to the religion room, or to the economy room. They don't go to the reference room. So the idea was to use part of the reference room and transforming it to make it a friendly space to host that service in a visible way. So that's nothing new. That's just the library as it always has been, but with a dedicated space for this activity. And of course, making it possible for people to work together in that space. And one of the challenging parts of the project was to achieve the transformation of reference librarians into digital humanities librarians. And the ones that were more worried about this were the reference librarians themselves, because they didn't really see how the digital humanities and digital collections and things that we were going to do related to things that they were doing before, like reference and consulting the catalogs and in all their forms. So we had the Aqualab, which is an internal structure at the BNF, more or less a project accelerator. It's people from the BNF who have been trained to use innovation methods like UX design and participative meetings and things like that to help the projects within BNF develop. So this innovation team worked during six months with the reference librarians to try and discuss with them how they could appropriate what we were doing with the Corpus project and with this digital humanities or digital scholarship project. So they worked on better understanding what was this new object and why it was related to what they were doing, and how they could also acquire the skills to do that kind of work. And one of the major things that came out of this was that they designed their own training curriculum, the thing that they wanted to learn. It's not at all a DH curriculum. It's really a curriculum for reference librarians that have to know what DH are. So they won't learn Python or R or things like that. They would just learn how the collections, digital collections, are structured, and how you can direct people to the API and dataset websites, how you can help them do their work. So I'm out of time, so I'm going to skip this one and jump right to my conclusion, which is the vision of what we are trying to build. And this vision is that tomorrow, when the researcher who wants to work for his DH projects will come to the BNF, to the X reading room, he will get an appointment, first with a reference librarian and an expert that will help him better define his projects, then we will provide him with all the information he needs for his call for project and tailored services. And once funded, maybe he will become a BNF resident. He will come work in that place with his fellow researchers and engineers. And if the rest of his team is not in Paris, maybe we can have a partnership with their university library so that they can also access part of the corpus that they need for their projects. And then that's the tricky part. If he's successful, if he's back enriched data or tools to the BNF so that we can propose them anew for other researchers and maybe integrate them in the roadmap in order to improve the service for all the users. So that's the thing we've done for the web archives I showed you before. First it was designed for a specific team and then it was integrated in the service that we give to all the readers. And that's it for today. There are many other things to tell you about this project and how it's going to develop, but maybe you have some questions.